Good afternoon, everyone. This is Laura Jackson, and we're here for lecture three of Botany Beginners, Grasses for the Masses. Welcome. We're just admitting a few more people in as they arrive. And so come and take your seats, grab that book, that hand lens. Maybe you've got an extra, maybe you've got a couple of pieces of grass in your hand, and we'll get started. So today, our topic is native cool season grasses that have been seeded somewhere on purpose, generally for conservation plantings on farms or on our county and state roadsides as part of the Iowa Roadside Management Program. Plus, we're going to do something new today. We're not just going to look at flowers. Today, we're going to look at five warm season grasses that haven't started flowering yet. And I'm going to try to teach you how to identify them without the flowers. How about that? After that, you will be a superhero. So let's just go ahead and launch into this. We have 70 participants so far. And of course, I've done something wrong here. I'm going to have to get out of screen share for a moment and fix this. Pardon me. All right. I don't know what I did. Okay. So just as a reminder, the resources that we've developed for you to help you with the class, we have video recordings that are provisional video recordings that we can't share on the website yet, but we're providing to you with a link by email until the closed captioning is completed in a couple of weeks. But until then, you can use those video recordings if you miss a lecture. These lectures are kind of build on each other. At least that's the idea. We have two handouts for you. One is the Iowa Grass Reference Guide, and it is on the website, and it was also shared on Facebook and Google Groups. And the customized grass key that we introduced last week that Price Johnson talked about, and that will very shortly be up on the website and was also shared on Facebook and Google Groups. So those two are references that should help you. And then today I'll be introducing a vegetative key for five important warm season grasses, and we'll get that up for you shortly. So if you remember, this is that Iowa Grass Reference Guide that we're using to kind of structure the course. The course outline, we've had two lectures so far last week, an introduction, and then the cool season grasses that are very common and found everywhere and often aggressive. And you learned how to use the Brown and Elliman guide, or at least we got a good start at learning it. Today, as I said, cool season grasses that are planted in CRP and roadsides. We're only doing sunny species and we're only doing native today. And then next week, we get to look forward to Dr. Justin Meissen talking about cool season grass species that are unique or nearly unique to prairie remnants. And that's going to be a lot of fun. And then later in the summer, it'll be all warm season grasses with kind of the same structure and two guest speakers also from the Tallgrass Prairie Center. So I wanted to spend a little bit of time talking about the homework. I have just loved seeing your photos. They're posted on Facebook. They're on Google Groups. You have amassed a long list of species, at least from these posts, that range from the first one is foxtail barley, and then small little barley, the various range of wild rye that are out there, all kinds of things that you've found. And there have been a few that have stumped me, and I've asked for a few more pictures, and I've asked for help from Justin and Laura Walter, and so we're trying to get to those soon, but if there's one that we've forgotten, please send me another little message and we'll try to get to it. So that's been a lot of fun. Now, that being said, that's about 23 of you who've participated in one way or another. And that means that there's a whole bunch that haven't. And so, of course, the teacher in me wonders, is it my fault? Or, you know, what more can we do to help you to learn? So I'm kind of curious if you wouldn't mind giving us some kind of an idea. If you're not doing the homework, or maybe you're doing it, but you're not posting it, just so we can get a sense. And all you have to do is write down the numbers here. You don't have to write it all out. Just write down a number one if you just haven't had time. Hey, we all understand this. This is just something we're doing for fun here. You're not getting any college credit. Maybe you haven't found any grasses that you really cared about yet. You're only concerned about certain species. I'm just making up some possible ideas. Maybe you know all the grasses so far. You're waiting until we get to the remnant species or something like that. Maybe you tried to key out something, but you got stuck and you just kind of threw up your hands and gave up. I really want to know if that's the case so we can help you out a little bit more. Maybe you're just shy to share that. Maybe you keyed it out, but you didn't post. Maybe you're afraid you might be wrong. Hey, everybody's wrong. That's the only way we learn here. So but you know, maybe that's a motivation. Some people are shy. Maybe you're just completely lost. I want to know that too, if that's the case. Just type in a number 6. Maybe you're having trouble with Google Groups or Facebook, and it's just too much trouble to deal with that stuff. I totally get that. But if that's the case, let us see if we can make a breakthrough there and knock down that barrier, because that would be a great shame if that's the issue. We'll fix it. And then I'm sure there are other reasons as well. So I see we've got about 16 responses in the chat and they're still going up. So I'll wait a couple minutes and then I'll get a sense from my trusty assistants here, Andrew and Anne, on what the predominant answers are.
Goodness, Laura, you were right. You predicted primarily people haven't had time, but we also have had a couple number 5s, a number 3, and a number 7.
Okay. All right. Well, we will follow up with you, the 5s and the 7s, so you know, make yourselves known to us, and we will try to make it right. And in terms of time, what can you do? Now that the pandemic's over, there's so many other fun things to do. But it is kind of like the difference between driving past the gym and saying, I ought to work out, versus going into the gym and working out. You know, we only one of those is going to get you a result, and we know which one that is. So my next question, and this is also something you can put in chat real quick. How many grasses are on your list? You're keeping a personal plant list of things that you can confidently identify. So just type into that chat, the number of species that you think you've got. I don't know how to distinguish between a 1 through 8 versus the number. Maybe put in a hashtag, you know, number, that's the number of species you can identify or something. Let's see how we're doing. I'm really curious if how we're doing on those species, plant species lists. And for my tech folks, there is somebody that's annotating on the screen here. It said Linda Burton there's a little red mark here. And I think there's a way to turn it off so that participants can't, I'm sure it's totally an accident, you didn't mean to. But I saw that in the first lecture, there was somebody who was accidentally annotating as they, unlike the last slide. So it's just a little funny little glitch. Yeah.
I have no idea.
Okay, well, it's a minor thing. Give me some of those personal plant list numbers. What have we got? Or is it hard to tell where the...
Yeah, some people are still answering the first question, so it's all...
Oh, didn't think about that.
5 or 6 new species.
Okay.
And Gina has learned 8 by sight.
Some people are like 13.
Wow.
Pretty good rate.
Yeah. 13. Wonderful. Okay. Well, keep up the good work. And you know, this is for you. This is to meet your goals, your learning goals, and those are various. So that's fine. That's all wonderful. Okay. We'll if you're still writing, go ahead. We'll capture that, and that'll help us to know how we're doing. For some reason, this doesn't want to use, and I did not touch anything, so I don't know why I'm going to have to go this way. So today, we're still in this scheme, cool season, and we're working with a more exclusive group of species that are only planted. You don't find them just everywhere or anywhere, and they're also found in prairie remnants. Plants of the day, we're going to look at Canada wild rye and its shady relatives. And we're also going to look at one you may not know at all or have heard of, foul manna grass, beautiful grass. Then we'll look at the warm season grasses from leaves only. And we'll have a guest, Dr. Justin Meissen from the Tallgrass Prairie Center, shown here with his wife and newborn son, Owen Reed, named after a grass, a woodland grass called Cinna arundinacea. And you can see in his hand, the baby's hand, he's holding some of that Cinna arundinacea. Isn't that wonderful? That kid has got a head start on grass ID for sure. Anyway, he's going to be talking about how he uses plant ID for monitoring in prairie restorations and making management decisions. The plant of the day is Elemis canadensis, or Canada wild rye. Now in the book, they call it something like Great Plains wild rye, and that's just because, you know, common names are quite variable. I've never heard that name before, but apparently it's used in other places. Giant wild rye is blooming right now. It's kind of got that bluish silver cast to it, kind of a glaucous sort of powdery substance on the stem that makes it look that way. You can kind of rub it off. And it's this this very bushy, bristly, very large inflorescence, maybe 6 or 8 inches long. You'll also see in places that haven't burned this last year, you'll see the old remnants of it from last year, and those spikelets generally fall off. But over time, the awns, those long awns that are straight this time of year, turn curly. And that's characteristic. Remember quackgrass? That was another plant in the same genus, Elemis. Elemis is a big genus, and quackgrass, if you remember here on the left, has those flower clusters or spikelets that are right up next to the stem, no branching at all. And it's got some bristles on it, but they're not very long in this on the left, but on the right over here, they can get actually pretty long. This picture kind of by Eric Miller, so he submitted, kind of stumped me for a while because I thought, well, that doesn't look like the quack grass in my backyard, but apparently there's quite a bit of range. But you can kind of see the family resemblance. It's an open grown weed with a strong rhizome. So let's quickly run the key on our this plant of the day, Canada wild rye. The first page of choices, page 23, describes four major groups. And the second group is if your plant has a round stem with no branches in the inflorescence. And that really goes well for Canada wild rye, as you can see from the spikelets that are just right up there next to that inflorescent stem with nothing in between, no branching. So then you get to the next level and you have some choices. And the first one is the correct one. It's cylindrical, the inflorescence is cylindrical, and it's bristly in silhouette, very, very bristly. When you get to that stage, you basically have four choices. Hordeum, which is a barley, Ceteria, which is the foxtails, those are warm season, so we can kind of cross those off our list. Elemis and Calaria. Calaria is June grass. I'm going to show you a picture of it later, but you never really see it in plantings, with some exceptions for pollinator plantings. It's generally only found in remnants. So we're kind of down to Hordeum and Elemis. And in fact, it is Elemis. And then there are two species that the book provides. One is Elymas virginicus, or Virginia wild rye, and the other is canadensis. The Elymas virginicus is not nodding. It doesn't flop over like that. It's a shorter ons, shorter overall inflorescence, and it has this stiff, straight appearance, whereas Elymas canadensis will tend to nod once it's fully out of the inflorescence, and it's got these long ons that eventually curl up, whereas virginicus does not. The other really important observation is the background here is this dark background. Elymas virginicus does get planted in open areas sometimes. Sometimes it's when Elymas canadensis seed isn't available, but it also is found in the wild in woodlands. Pardon me, that's the glitch that I had hoped I had figured out how to stop. I'm gonna try one more time. Excuse me, very quickly. I just need to get out of the share. Back into share. Actually, I'm going to do my whole screen. Then, all right. Now, there are a few other species that some of you saw out there in the wild, and I call them the Canada wild rye shady relatives because they all live in the shade or partial sun. One is Elymas villosus, which is silky wild rye. It's got a little longer ons or bristles. It is a little bit more nodding. It's a little bit of a shorter inflorescence. And the key thing that I don't have a picture of, sorry, is the fact that it is has a silky or fuzzy leaf sheath. And that will be really obvious when you look at that leaf sheath, as opposed to Elymas canadensis, which has that more of that powdery bloom on it. And then here's a beautiful one, Elymas hystrix, the squirrel tail grass or bottle brush grass there in the center. Also found in the shade or partial shade, it grows up straight, it doesn't nod. The spikelets, instead of being pressed up to the stem like this, are completely out almost at a 90 degree angle. Isn't that cool? So that's pretty fun. And that makes it very distinctive and hard to miss. But it is one of the shady relatives. It's not typically found in open areas, and it's sold for savanna seed mixes, but it's not really found in seed mixes for prairie. So let's take a quick botany break and figure out how you are doing. If you have any questions or things that I didn't explain very well, now would be a good time to share that in the chat. Nope. All right. I must be doing perfect job. So two species, really only two species of cool season native grasses get used in prairie plantings today. And it's kind of unfortunate because you're going to find out about some really neat species that are only found in remnants that might work out very well in prairie plantings if we figured out how to grow them for seed production. The two are Elymas canadensis, and the next one I'm going to show you, Glyceria striata, which is foul manna grass. Foul manna grass is a gorgeous grass. It's native to wetlands. It was mentioned and specifically by Lewis Pamel in the book Pastures and Meadows of Iowa, which was published in 1901, as a promising native grass for forage. So we have a lot of wet prairies, wet areas that were used for cattle grazing rather than for corn at that time. Now they've all been tiled and they're mostly gone, but it's a native grass that livestock like, and maybe under proper management, we could have maintained it in the landscape. Anyway, a key factor here is prominent veins on the flower scales. And this is something that's easy to see with the naked eye. These veins kind of stick out. That's really what they mean by prominent. They're actually, you know, ridges. And they get even more obvious as the inflorescence matures. The inflorescence also is composed, it's a panicle. It's composed of short spikelets with just a few florets in each one. On the right, you can see the inflorescence as it matures and it kind of turns purple. And there you could also see those ridges are really obvious. And it's also very rounded, isn't it? It's not as pointy as the Elymas is. And then there are some vegetative characters that you can also use to help identify it. So if you're following the key, this would sort of be the outline of the key. You choose a round or two-sided stem with branches arranged vertically, in other words, a panicle. The inflorescence is definitely droopy and it's sparse and delicate. It doesn't have a lot of spikelets close together. And then once you get to that point, there's only two genera that would grow in full sun, Glyceria and Lyrsia. And Lyrsia is really only found in remnants. So you're pretty much down to Glyceria or foul manna grass from the get-go. But then there are several species of Glyceria you have to choose from. And the book has a really nice, helpful guide in there. I think that's page 148. There's a helpful guide that says, how do you tell the different species of Glyceria apart? And then you just kind of follow those instructions. So that would be a neat one to find if you can find it. It's very distinctive and it'll be very pretty this time of year. As I mentioned, there's one other Calaria macrantha June grass, which does bloom in June. And Justin's going to cover this one with the remnant prairies nest next week, but it was included in many, many seed mixes for the CP42 Pollinator Conservation Reserve Program. Whether it came up or not is another story, but it was definitely included in a lot of seed mixes. And it's gorgeous as well when it's in flower. So very quick break because there weren't any questions on the other one, but I do want to give a shout out to Minnesota Wildflowers because some of those images I borrowed from their website and copied and pasted because they're the very best images you can find. And I didn't have those species around to take pictures of myself. So a big thank you. And of course I have increased my botany karma by contributing to Minnesota Wildflowers. That's how I can identify so many species. And I encourage you to give them $5 for the year. I think that's all they ask is an annual subscription is $5 a year. So any questions to cover?
I had a couple of questions come in. What was the common name for E. villosus?
Oh, that Elymas villosus, E. villosus, is silky wild rye.
Okay.
Silky wild rye, yeah.
Also a question, are the shady relatives growing in the shade and or not wanted in the prairie?
That's a great question. So plants love sunlight. That's how they get their energy. That's how they grow. But there are some species that are well adapted to shady conditions and they can do well in competition with others. I guess one way to think of it would be to say that Canada wild rye is relatively intolerant of shade and can also survive the competition with other grasses and wildflowers in full sun. If you put something like silky wild rye or squirrel tail / bottle brush grass, that is Elymas hystrix, if you put it in a prairie in full sun, in competition with other things, they would probably get beat up pretty good before they disappeared entirely, because they're just not as good a competitor as some of the grasses that are more adapted to sun. Now, if you're, say you have it in your yard, like I have Elymas hystrix in my yard, my prairie, it's on the north side of the house, but that area is pretty shady. So I think it persists fine there because it kind of has a competitive advantage. Does that make sense? It's all about tolerance of tough conditions. And yeah, the shade is kind of tough conditions for some grasses, but others can handle it.
Yeah, Bart also had some questions about the text, and Terry was kind enough to post the name of the reference guide we're using, but there is a link on the website.
Okay, there is a link on the website for that grass reference guide, and there will soon be one, or if there isn't already, for that modified key that Price talked about last week that just takes and collapses our grasses, sedges, and rushes. It just collapses it down to just the grasses, and then it eliminates everything that's in a salt marsh or in the shade, because we're not covering that in this class. And what you've got left is a much shorter key that's more specific to Iowa. So it eliminates the sedges, the rushes, things that grow in the shade, things that grow in salt marshes, And then it also annotates it whether it's a warm season grass or a cool season grass. So then it lines up really nice with that guide that we made. So they kind of go together. All right, so now we're gonna learn 5 grasses from leaf characters. And at the end of this, you are going to feel like a superhero or a Norse god, because this is like the most one of the most difficult things to do in botany. There's a bunch of caveats, of course, that'll go with it, but we're gonna look at relative size. We're gonna look at characteristics of the sheath, the ligule, and the collar, including the auricle. We're gonna look at tiller shape, and I'll explain all what these things are. We're gonna look at specific types of hairs growing in particular places. And then one that we won't cover, but is kind of obvious, is to look around for old seed stocks. And sometimes you can get the plant ID just from an old seed stock that hasn't been burned the previous year. So let's tackle this. Relative size of vegetative tillers is always tricky because it's relative and you can't always rely on it. Plants are very plastic. They grow bigger when they're happy and they have good water and sun. They grow smaller when they don't. The tallest big blue stem on our campus can grow 8 feet high, and the tallest big blue stem in the Flint Hills of Kansas might only be 3 feet high. But relative to one another in the same environment, they're going to occupy this range of typical sizes. And that can be a nice clue that can help and augment some of the other things you're going to look at that are more specific. So with that caveat, we've got Kentucky bluegrass on the left, Poa pratensis. We have little blue stem as the next largest one to its right. And then we have Cydotes gramma, which is also a fairly small grass. Not surprisingly, both little blue stem and Cydotes are adapted to drier sites. And that's not coincidental. Then on the right of the meter tape, we have 3 of the big grasses: Indian grass, switchgrass, and big blue stem. And Indian grass and big blue stem will get to be about the same size, but in the seed production plots that I was collecting these specimens from, Indian grass was a little smaller than big blue stem, at least this time of year. Switchgrass there in the middle is a bit different because it's already starting to flower. And when you send up a seed stock, that seed stock is much bigger than a vegetative tiller. So the growing point of that particular tiller is up in the air. So, but it still belongs with the big grasses in general. So let me show you some examples of what that looks like in the field. This is a seed production plot of little blue stem. That's the fine textured grasses there. And then, but there is some Indian grass that's invaded it. And those are the big leaves that you can see popping up there. And those big leaves mean that is not little blue stem. Sure, it's green. Sure, they're long linear leaves with parallel veins, but little blue stem never looks like that. And so when you can pick up on that subtle cue of that texture, that larger size, it's like the difference between a fox and a wolf. You know, they're both dogs, but they're both canines, but they come in different general sizes. And you can generally tell that by looking at them. Here is another example. This is a seed production plot of Indian grass, but there are several places where big blue stem big blue stem has invaded. And hopefully you can see that and this, and maybe this little clump back here, and surely this clump here, are a bit different from the rest of the Indian grass. And those sorts of cues, believe it or not, when your eyeballs are calibrated, you will start to pick up on those things. It won't be the only thing you need to identify it, but it will help you to see it. And I couldn't help but throw this in. This is big blue stem, which is a very big grass, but then we have Tripsicum dactyloides, or eastern gamma grass, here, and it is much bigger than big blue stem. And it's just another example of that contrast. Tripsicum dactyloides or Eastern gamma grass is related to corn. And you can see this very light colored leaf here, a light colored midrib on the top of the leaf, which might just remind you of a very large warm season grass that you know very well. So, okay, now we got to get into the tough stuff. And this is where you have to keep that goal in mind. Is that this is hard to remember all these, and it's hard to keep them all straight for a large number of grasses, and they're variable and so forth. But here's what you have to work with besides relative size, and that is a limited set of characters around the leaf sheath, the leaf blade, and this collar region here, which can include a ligule, what the arrow is pointed to, and it can include little processes coming out at the end that kind of look like little hooks. They may be small, they may be large, that are sometimes called auricles. So the vegetative keys or the vegetative characters that you have to pay attention to are all in this small little area. Make sure you use a nice example of a young leaf, not something that's old and beaten up, because then some of those features can disappear. Another character that we're going to look at is the tiller shape at the base of the tiller. The very base, get down near the ground, 2-3 centimeters off the ground at the most, and you want to feel the shape of that tiller in your hand. It can be almost perfectly round, like the one on the left. It can be flattened and oval-ish, like the one in the middle, or it can be so flat, so paper thin flat, it feels like an envelope with a rejection letter in it. It's just a few folded pieces of leaf in there. And for the ones on the right, I couldn't stand them up straight like I did these. They're on their side because they're so small, they would tip over. I couldn't get them to stand up. So they're very, very small.
Hey, Laura.
Yeah.
Can you define tiller for people?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I apologize. So the tiller is kind of the fundamental unit of the grass plant. It is a branch, if you will. At the base of the tiller is where all the leaves are coming from. That's the growing point. So there'll be a little growing point there with, it's called a meristem, with cells that are continually dividing. It's a stem cell, quite literally. And each of those, it's a bud, and that bud will start producing leaves. And the leaves grow up like this, but the bud stays down there close to the ground. So it's protected from fire, it's protected from grazing. It's why when you mow your lawn, you immediately start seeing regrowth because the bud is unaffected. So it's a cluster of leaves that were all produced by one bud, one growing meristem or bud. And when it gets, and then it will start to branch and create new little tillers off the sides of it. I hope that was, I should have known that was a term, because it's kind of like if you take a tree with all those branches at the tips with all the leaves, now imagine you just buried that tree up to those branch tips. That's what a grass plant is. It's just a buried tree with all of the branch tips right there at the surface of the soil. So, you know, each tiller might have 4 or 5 leaves on it. And then eventually some of those tillers become reproductive and shoot up and become tall and tall like that. I'm glad you asked that. So another thing that can really catch you is hairiness. There's so much variation in hairiness in plants, especially these grasses. Some are super hairy, some are completely glabrous and smooth as a baby's bottom. And they can all be within a few feet of each other in the same species. So hairiness is not a good character unless it's a very specific kind of observation you're making. And in the case of one grass that we'll talk about in a bit, the leaf margins, the very edge of the grass blade, down towards the base of that grass blade, there are hairs sticking up that have a little gland at the base of them. You can call it a bulge or a gland. This is an example of a glandular hair with that bump there that's white. And they tend to also sort of look like they're equidistant from each other. You tend to see them kind of about spaced pretty evenly. That's an example of a hair that you can use for identification. And I'll show you in a minute which species that is. Maybe some of you already know. So here is the key that I developed to help my students learn so they could go out and collect data. And then they turned it into this diagram. So we'll walk through it. It's a series of yes or no questions. And the first is, does it have a super flat stem? And if the answer is yes, here on the right, then we can pretty confidently recognize it as little blue stem or Schizocarium scoparium. That stem is so flat, it feels like an envelope with a few folded, just like one or two pages of letter inside that envelope. If it's not flat, then you go on to the second choice. The second choice, let me show you an image. Yeah, here's the image. Whoops, I didn't mean for that to be there, but I can't edit it now. The little blue stem has a very flat stem. It's relatively small. And this is the kind of showing the relative size of the tillers and their flatness. Big blue stem is flat, but little blue stem's really flat. And generally that's a slam dunk. We don't have to go any further. So the next one is, does it have a bulge at the base of the hairs on the leaf margins? And that's the picture that I was showing you earlier. If it does, it's Cydotes gramma, also a slam dunk. Butalua curtipendula, one of the most beautiful Latin names in the Latin in the plant systematics. And here you can see that bulgy little process there. It's on the edge of the leaf. The leaf's kind of curled, kind of cupped right now. And there's that glandular hair on those edges. And generally, if you look up, if you get the right light, generally you can see that with the naked eye or grab that hand lens and take a quick look. The combination of being a relatively small grass and having those little bumps on there, it will give you a solid ID for Cydotes gramma. Now, make sure that leaf isn't damaged. The older the leaf, the more those hairs have rubbed off. And so treat it carefully and try to find a nice leaf or leaf group of leaves, tiller, that is not damaged. Here's another picture which came out pretty well. Now, we're down to the next one. If it's not, it doesn't have a hairs with a bulge at the base, then now we're looking for hairy armpits. That's just a way to remember that. What do hairy armpits mean? It means that we're looking at the place where the leaf blade meets the leaf sheath. You pull that leaf blade back, kind of at an awkward angle, and you'll see kind of a triangle of dense hairs, dense pubescence there in that area. And you'll also see a fringe of hairs here where for the ligule. Here's another shot of the same leaf. There's that hairy armpit and also the hairy ligule. And that is a dead ringer for switchgrass, Panicum virgatum. So if you've got that, boom, you've got an ID there and you can feel smart. Now, the very last one is the one that sometimes can be tricky if you're working with grasses that are still early in the season. If you're anxious to get out there and in early June and try to ID these, you might not see these characters. But the difference between big blue stem and Indian grass, since we've eliminated everything else now, boils down to two characters. One is the collar ligule area, and one is the shape of the tiller, back to that tiller shape idea, the base of the stem. And I mean, you need to get down 3 to 5 centimeters above the ground and really roll that between your fingers to determine what is that cross section. You know, getting out an X-Acto knife and cutting cross sections is not very practical. You want to be able to just reach down and feel it in your fingers, make sure you're not getting into any wild parsnip or or something else, even worse, poison ivy on the way down. So Indian grass has a round cross section, and it has a very woody ligule and auricle on this edge. So this is the leaf blade. This is the leaf sheath. If you can see my little laser pointer, I wish it was a bigger laser pointer. There's the blade, there's the sheath, and where these two meet, there's sort of a woody process here that some people think looks like an ear, thus the word auricle. Also, they think this whole area looks like a gun sight that you could use to aim at. And that's that is characteristic of Indian grass, Sorghastrum nutans. So if you can spot that, there's nothing else that looks like that. This is a good place to kind of note that if you think about the biomechanics of this grass, it's got to be able to keep these leaves erect and up in the sun when they're 3-4 feet tall, which is quite a trick when you don't have any woody tissue. It's not, they're not a tree. And so you can sort of see the architecture of this that allows it to stay upright. Here's Big Bluestem in contrast. There's no auricle. The ligule is a membrane or kind of a ragged membrane. It's not woody, it's soft. And the stem in cross section is flattened. It's not round, it's not super flat like Little Bluestem. It's in between, but it's definitely an oval shape. It will not roll in your fingers in the same way. So those two things distinguish Big Bluestem and Indian grass from one another. Big Bluestem on the left, no ligule, no auricle here. Well, it does have a ligule, excuse me. No auricle sticking up, no ears, no gun sight, oval in cross section versus Indian grass, circular in cross section and with this gun sight. So, you know, it's remembering a lot of trivial little details like that that allows you to ID these things without seed heads, but eventually you kind of, it kind of comes naturally after a while with practice, with lots of practice. Also, there are, you know, there are in-betweens. Nature doesn't obey our rules. And so it can be frustrating until you've done it a lot and had some practice seeing the range of things that are out there. So here it is again. I will post this and you can take a look at it, and I challenge you to try it and maybe you'll be successful. So now that you have superhero status, let's see if there are any questions from folks on that little key.
Don't think so.
Wow, okay. Well, I really, really hope that key helps you out and is can help you start to see these warm season grasses before they go into flower. Of course, later this summer in August, Dr. Christine Nemec will be going over some of these warm season grasses that flower late in the year and that have been planted in roadsides. She's the director of the program manager for the Iowa Roadside Program, and also grasses that were planted in prairie restorations and conservation reserve plantings.
You have one question from Shelley Ward. How do you tell the difference between Little Bluestem and broom sedge?
Ooh, Little Bluestem and broom sedge. Well, that totally exposes the charlatan that I am here, folks. If you have more than this group of species, this key doesn't necessarily work if you have that in it. I would have to go and look at broom sedge and see, because it is an andropogon. It's related, and it probably has some pretty good similarities to Little Bluestem, but I haven't looked at it yet. So that's a great point. And we'd have to look at Lauren Brown and Ted Elliman, and also just at look at the plants themselves to see. Probably we'll get unlucky. It'll have a round stem, and then we'll have to change everything about this key. That's the thing about these keys. They're very specific to the collection of species that you decide to put in them. If it's simple, that's great. Everybody likes simple. But then you throw in a novel species and the whole thing falls apart. Yeah, great question. Anything else?
I don't think so.
Okay. All right. Now we have a surprise for you. Dr. Justin Meissen, who's our research and restoration program manager at the Tallgrass Prairie Center, has graciously agreed to have a little chat here online with us about how he uses grass identification in making decisions about prairie restoration and prairie management after something's been planted. And so I am going to turn it, well, I should also introduce him a little bit more. He has his PhD from University of Minnesota in restoration ecology, and he started here at the Tallgrass Prairie Center in 2016. And we're very happy to have him here to talk about how he uses grass ID and prairie restoration. And if there's time, there might be time for a couple questions for Justin. So go ahead, Justin.
Yeah, thanks, Laura. So let's talk a little bit about kind of the practicality of what we're learning, because it's very, very useful. So this is actually a perfect example here, this photograph of this is a situation where I went to assess a prairie strip for one of our partners. And as you can see, that prairie strip is covered in grass. So we kind of need to know what that is, because that will either tell us we're succeeding or we're failing miserably and we need to start over. So knowing what that grass is it one species? Is it multiple species? How many of the different kinds of grasses are in that stand helps us decide what to do with it. So this is a situation where knowing maybe a couple important native grass species is good. So this is a first year planting, this picture here. And so, sorry, just a second.
Oh, we have some people in the lobby that are making a little noise.
Okay, sorry about that. So we were talking about a couple different plant grass species that could really make or break our management choices. So in the first year planting like this, if we saw, for example, Brummus inermis, if that were the grass that was coming up in this stand here, which you all learned in the second lecture, that would be a complete disaster. So, Brummus inermis is a perennial plant, an invasive species. Once it's established, it's very difficult to get out of a stand. But that also tells us, if we don't start over from scratch, what we might also do to manage that species, which would be annual burning, spring burning, which would differentially impact the brome compared to our warm season grasses, like we've been talking about, been learning about these differences in growth, cool season versus warm season, and we can use that to make management decisions. But more likely what's happening in a situation like we're seeing here is it's depending on the time of year, it could be boxtail, could be an annual warm season weed, which is very typical of a agricultural landscape, removing farming from a site. That is very typical of high densities in the first year, but with establishment mowing during the first year, preventing seed set and keeping light available to the establishing native seeds, seedlings, it really isn't a problem and it will go away on its own over time. So those are totally different scenarios that, if you made the wrong decision, if you made the wrong ID, you might have destroyed a perfectly good planting and lost, several thousands of dollars worth of seed and added several thousands of dollars in reseeding costs to your project just because you made a wrong plant ID. So, and then the third option that, you know, typically might come up would be, and I don't know that we'll go into them too much, but cover crops or stuff that we did plant. And so knowing what plants that you planted, what plants, you know, where are the most common weeds, having that information, being able to identify that kind of stuff really pays off, because you can make the right management decisions that are going to save you a lot of headaches.
Yeah.
So I guess at this point, I don't know, I think I saw a couple questions, or at least one question.
Yeah, do we have a couple questions for Justin? I think we have time.
What was the second grass you mentioned, the annual?
What was the second grass you mentioned, the annual?
Yeah, so foxtail species, it could be a couple different species, but they're all in the same Ceteria genus or foxtail genus. The most common one, I think, there's two really common ones in our part of Iowa, which is yellow foxtail and giant foxtail, Ceteria fabrii.
Yeah. Another question?
Yes, we have a question for you, Laura. Is there a good way to disarticulate a floret to examine the floret parts?
So the question was kind of on a separate topic, but is there a good way to disarticulate the florets to examine the parts? And I would say that that's definitely an advanced skill. You want a, oftentimes, depending on the size of the grass, you need a good set of tweezers. That's not the right word. Some forceps. You need a good light source, and you need a dissecting scope or a good hand lens to do that. And it can be very, very illuminating when you do. I've stayed away from that level because I didn't want to scare you all off. And it is kind of fun, but it definitely takes that extra level of superhero to get to that point. Any other questions for Justin on management?
We do. With native grass establishments, is it fair to expect them to come up the first year? Do any take longer to establish?
Is it fair to expect the grasses to come up the first year, or should we wait a second year for them to show up in a planting?
Yeah, so that's a very good question, and it kind of all depends on what we mean by show up. So in the first year, by the end of the growing season, September, the majority of the grasses, depending on when you planted it, they have come up as, and they are seedlings. Most of the time, they are rarely taller than 6 or 7 inches. In a good year, they can get pretty big, but typically they're really small. And if you haven't mowed, or you mowed, a while ago, they will be just essentially they will not show themselves to you. You have to look for them. You have to get on your hands and knees and look for them, and kind of look through the vegetation. So technically, yeah, they're there by the end of the first year, but they are they're definitely not easily identifiable by the first year in general. Second year, they almost always are. In terms of the relative sizes of the grasses that have come up, you know, your Elmus canadensis, which we talked about today, definitely reaches its maximum size. A lot of the other ones are not quite there yet. They're, you know, half to three quarters of the full size that they'll be in a couple of years. And usually by the third or fourth year, the native grasses that you planted have reached their maximum size. So to answer your question, you know, really briefly, yeah, they established the first year, but they don't, they're not easy to find until the second or third year.
That's really an important topic. And, you know, I think it all comes back to, can you ID the plant in the first place? And that's what this class is all about. Once you've got that building block, foundation, then you can start to make these other more sophisticated judgment calls about management. So thank you so much, Justin. I really appreciate you sitting in here and being part of this today. I'd like to go ahead and finish the rest of the lecture. And then if there's time or towards the end, I'll catch any remaining students after class, and we can continue to have a discussion with your questions, and maybe Justin can stay behind as well. So thank you again, Justin. So let's see. I wanted to end with one very interesting point that's been made over and over, but the very important plant ecologist Henry David Thoreau, who is apparently also known for philosophy or something, I don't know, civil disobedience, Walden, that type of stuff. But his main deal was he was a plant ecologist, and he had some really interesting observations about what it means to recognize plants. And so I want to, with your permission, I want to read this quote, and then there's another one right after. It's from his journal in 1858. The scarlet oak must, in a sense, be in your eye when you go forth. We cannot see anything until we are possessed with the idea of it, and then we can hardly see anything else. In my botanical rambles, I find that first the idea or image of a plant occupies my thoughts, though it may at first seem very foreign to this locality. And for some weeks or months, I go thinking of it and expecting it unconsciously. And at length, I surely see it, and it is henceforth an actual neighbor of mine. This is the history of my finding a score or more rare plants which I could name. So it's this idea that it's really hard to see something or to recognize it until you have some sort of image in your mind of what it is. And he did, in fact, discover several rare plants that nobody knew were growing around Walden. He was a famous walker. He walked miles and miles and miles and made incredible observations. But here's the second idea, which is kind of in opposition to this one. And it's just as important when you think about learning your plants, especially the grasses, from October of 1859. It is only when we forget all our learning that we begin to know. I do not get nearer by a hair's breadth to any natural object, so long as I presume that I have an introduction to it from some learned man or woman, I suppose. To conceive of it with a total apprehension, I must for the thousandth time approach it as something totally strange. If you would make acquaintance with the ferns, you must forget your botany. And I just think that's an amazing insight into the powers of observation and how we learn about something so foreign to us as this plant that is so completely unlike a human being that it takes so much to get to know it. So I hope that it means something to you. So in summary, today we learned two plants of the day, Elemis canadensis, Canada wild rye, plus some of its shady relatives. And we also learned about foul manna grass, a wetland plant, foul manna grass, which is Glyceria striata. And we looked at five warm season grasses from leaves only. We got a few pieces of terminology under our belt. I should add tiller to that, and relative plant size and the use of a simple key. And we talked about grass ID and prairie restoration, how important it is to know some of these key grasses and what to do about them. And then finally, a little bit from our friend, the famous plant ecologist, Henry David Thoreau, insights on learning botany. So practice, maybe share a selfie of a grass you've found or your favorite place to botanize. I'd love to see some of the faces of the masses that are taking this class. And we would just love to see that, whether it is a picture of a grass you've ID'd or just one that you found out there. Send us a picture, put it in the group, the Facebook group, or in the Google group. We would love to see it. And second task that I would suggest is to try and find and ID a late flowering warm season grass from your favorite restoration planting, or possibly a prairie remnant, although that gets a lot harder, using those leaf characteristics. Maybe at least you look at those leaf characteristics and you go, nope, it's none of these five. That's good. That's progress. even if you know that you don't know it, you at least know it's, you've ruled out five species that it could not be. That's still progress. Finally, there are some new species that are starting to come on. This warm, dry summer has advanced the bloom times of several warm season species. I'm seeing foxtails, I'm seeing switchgrass that's blooming. The prairie cordgrass outside our center door is also starting to emerge. And so you're going to start to find some of these warm season grasses. They're much bigger and they typically bloom a little bit later in the summer. But it's fun to start paying attention to those. And next week, we have our own Justin Meissen, who's going to be talking about the native cool season grasses that you find almost exclusively in prairie remnants. And that is going to be a lot of fun. There's some fascinating and quite beautiful species, and maybe some that ought to be in your next native planting if you can get a hold of the seed. So I'm really looking forward to that. And with that, we still have time. Let's just do the thank you slide for Tallgrass. For Practical Farmers of Iowa, College of Humanities, Arts, and Sciences at UNI, and Green Iowa AmeriCorps, and my wonderful tech assistants, Ann and Andy here, who have just been so helpful today. So with those acknowledgments, you class is dismissed, but I will stick around for more comments and questions and discussion, and Justin will too. So. Thanks, everybody, and feel free to take off anytime you want or stick around for discussion.
So we do have a couple comments. Thank you for encouraging a grass obsession. And
thank you for encouraging a grass obsession. I don't know if the microphone picked it up. Probably did.
We had one person ask to go back to the decision tree sketch.
Okay. Going back to the decision tree sketch without Wonder Woman. There you go. So you start by diving in and feeling that stem to see if it's really flat like a rejection letter envelope. If it is, you're done. Next, you look at the edge of the leaf, leaf blade near the base of that leaf blade for any hairs that are sticking out that have a gland at the base of them. If it's not there, then you go for to see, well, does that that inside of that leaf blade have a hairy armpit? Is there a lot of fuzz there? If not, and you're in a very, you know, common planting with low diversity, you're looking at big blue stem or Indian grass. Other thoughts on that?
A question on Canada wild red grass. I was told it could cut a dog's eye if they ran through it, and was encouraged not to plant it. Is it long-lived?
Is it long-lived? Not very, right, Justin? Canada wild rye is not very long-lived. It does still persist. You will see it out there in a planting after many years. It's still there. It's just not in the abundance that you typically would see it in year one, year two, year three, where there is a lot of it. You know, I think any grass would cut your eye or your dog's eye. I mean, so many of them are very rough and they're like a paper cut. Eastern gamma grass is terrible, of course. So is Spartina, cordgrass, rip gut sawgrass. Switchgrass, you can see those little kind of spiky teeth on the edge of the leaf margin. So there really isn't a big warm season grass that couldn't cut your eye. They need to be sensible dogs when they run through. Great question. I don't know. Have you heard anything about that, Justin?
Yeah, I've heard not about cutting the eye, but I've heard the seeds becoming problematic and getting wedged in various places on the face.
Right.
I can say walking through a prairie restoration that's 2-3 years old, you get all kinds of the LMS seeds in the various nooks and crannies of your socks and shoes. So, I mean, I can see it might not be comfortable, but I don't know that that's, I don't think it's a reason to not plant it. It would be, if you're concerned, I wouldn't plant very much of it. That would be the main suggestion. You don't have to have a extremely dense stand of it in your prairie restoration, but it should be in every prairie restoration in Iowa.
Yeah, so it's a good tool. Other questions or thoughts?
Mm-hmm. Please review the bit about the bulge at the hair base.
Okay, let's review the bit about the bulge at the base of the hair in Side Oats Grandma, Boutaloua curtipendula. So it's this structure here where my, in the very center of this photo where my laser pointer is. So the leaf margin's going along and then there's a tiny little bump there. And that is that glandular hair or bulge at the base of this hair. The hairs can be quite long. I mean, this could be a centimeter long, this hair, if it doesn't get broken off. And there's another one. And what you see when you look at it is just a little white, just a little nub there, just a little white nub at the base of that, at the base of that hair. That's all it is, but it's so distinctive. You don't really see that in any other grass on the prairie. And so, you know, it's a nice positive ID. Yeah, other questions or?
A student wanted to let us know that I think it was Big Blue Stem was blooming in Southwest.
Big Blue Stem's blooming in Southwest Minnesota. Interesting. I did see some Big Blue Stem in boot, meaning the seed heads are still in the leaf sheath, but are starting to pop out in our seed production plots here in Black Hawk County. So, yeah, that's one of those that's probably pretty is advanced compared to a normal year. And, you know, it does show kind of the resilience and the malleability of our native grasses. And, you know, it suggests that with climate change, we will see changes in phenology because they are adaptable to a certain extent. They're adaptable. I know when I went south to Kansas a couple weekends ago, their big blue stem was already blooming. So that's also, is, you know, because you're further south, of course. Yeah, all these times really are relative. So if you're further north or south, or if it's cooler or wetter or warmer or hotter, you know, the phenology is all relative, which is a good thing for plants. Otherwise, they would have a lot, even a harder trouble surviving. Yeah. That tailing off on the questions? Okay. Well, wonderful. It's always fun to hear what's on your mind. And I do hope I see some faces in some pictures, some selfies of you out in the field trying to ID things. If you are struggling with just the that initial step with the key, I'd be glad to go over with you one-on-one. And I'm sure we can figure it out so that you can make some progress on your own personal plant list. So please do reach out and let me know either individually or on the Facebook group. The Facebook group is there, and also the Google group, they're very good at helping one another. So you may post something and you may hear from me, and you may also hear from some others who say, oh, I think it's that. So that's fun. That's a way we can try to make this massive class a little bit more personal and little more relatable. So please do use that. All right, any last thoughts here before we sign off? Okay, if not, thank you all for your attention. We will see you next week at 3 with Justin Meissen, and enjoyed it very much. Bye-bye, everybody.